Let me tell you a story to explain why I'm making this video. When I was working my last full-time job, I was essentially leading my department. To set the stage, this was a very stressful week for me already. Our need for 3D assets was growing really rapidly, and I needed to hire a 3D contractor to join us. I was underwater on 3D asset creation since I was both working as the main engineer on the software project, managing our software contractor, and also working as the only 3D artist. On top of that, someone had literally stolen the roof off of my car earlier that week. No, I'm not joking, they stole my whole roof. The Bay Area at the end of COVID was pretty wild. Anyway, I put out hiring posts on several different job boards, and I started going through the resumes and portfolios I got. And I got a lot. I'll first say, I tried my best to respond to basically everybody who applied, because I know the frustration of being on the other end of this and sending dozens of applications and just hearing nothing at all. There are a few pretty great resumes, and I'll give an example in a second, but I have to say, I got a ton of, and there's no way around this, really terrible ones. I was already underwater with work and bummed that my car now had no roof, and going through 100 plus resumes just to have 90% of them be shockingly terrible was very frustrating. So that's ultimately why I'm making this. I want to go over what somebody hiring is actually thinking about your resume and how you can use that to your advantage to make a resume that will actually land you an interview and hopefully a job.
Oh, Lord.
Let's start off with the worst offender. One of the resumes I got was both the person's resume and portfolio in the same document. Oh, they included a link, you might say? No.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
It was a plain Word document, and it had no formatting. The work experience listed was totally irrelevant to 3D. The portfolio was a set of seemingly random project images with no information, pasted haphazardly into a, need to say this again, Word document. What I'm showing you is a recreation, since I don't want to blast some random person publicly like this, but I want to help all of you avoid doing this yourself. Many of the resumes I got, I filtered by talent and kept on file for the next round of hiring, but a whole lot of them, especially this one, went straight in the trash. There are a few distinct things that I've seen in the resumes that I've reviewed that make them weaker candidates, and I want to stress that I'm not every hiring manager, so the best I can offer you is my opinion.
What's good for me? That's my opinion!
That said, I think I've distilled this video down to some tips that should apply to basically every 3D position, if not all of them, and the ones that it doesn't apply to, I think you can probably read between the lines and apply the things that are relevant and avoid the things that aren't. The first thing I saw a bunch of was just plain old bad formatting. This one has to be particularly egregious to significantly ding your chances of getting hired, but it's important nonetheless. Now, I've noticed this kind of comes in two categories. Outright bad design, and by that I mean stuff like the example I gave previously where the resume is just a Word document with random stuff all over the place. It's just a crazy mess overall.
Huh?
If your resume looks like this as a 3D designer, I'm going to assume you cannot design things without strict guidelines, and you're going to be disorganized and at minimum hard to manage. If you find yourself creating a resume like this, I'd highly suggest using a simple template or some kind of guideline and selecting your information carefully and then sticking close to that provided formatting. The second category of bad design I've seen is over-design. I think designers especially fall into this trap, thinking our resumes need to be beautifully designed because, hey, that's what we do for a living. But there's an equally important thing to consider as a designer: intent. The intent of a resume is to convey the relevant experience you hold to the position you're applying for as quickly and efficiently as possible. If you overcrowd your resume with a bunch of semi-relevant graphs and non-text items, you run the risk of making the information it contains way harder to digest. And if I, the hiring manager, have seen 200 resumes that day, and 100 of them were very design-heavy and difficult to read, and 100 of them were simple and boring, I'm going to retain the information from the simple and boring ones and not the difficult-to-read ones. Now, maybe you're an incredible designer, and your resume genuinely does stand out for the rest while still being very elegant, but if that's the case, you probably don't need to see this video. Happy to have you here, though. You should subscribe and join the Discord so you can show us all your cool resume. The second major issue I've seen with people's resumes is not the way the resumes look, but the information they've chosen to include in it. Truthfully, you should have a resume for each industry you apply to. If I'm hiring 3D and I get a resume with zero 3D experience, but 5 years in logistics, that's not going to tell me anything I need to know about hiring you. Now, it's possible you have no formal experience in 3D, and my advice in that situation is generally to do a little bit of contracting if you can. If not that, do some volunteer projects, but just anything to get a little bit of something on your resume that isn't just personal projects. Keep relevant work experience that speaks to your ability to do a job long term, but make sure your resume has something relevant to what you're applying for if that's at all possible. You can get around this if you have a stellar portfolio, though. Essentially, In a choice between seeing 1 year of McDonald's, 5 years of logistics, and 1 year at a restaurant versus 1 year of McDonald's, 5 years of logistics, and 1 year of contract advertisement for local brands, etc., I'd rather see the second. Even though the last entry is contract work, isn't full-time, might be more scattered, it still sells me that you can do this job when actual money and actual work are on the table. The other thing about that is your portfolio also matters a lot, and I'm going to go over that in another video about building a good portfolio. The last thing that I'd really caution against heavily with a resume is including so much information on it that it ends up being longer than a page. I've seen a bunch of these, and it's a real shame because if you read between the lines, they didn't actually usually have to be that way. See, in my experience, people who pack a ton of stuff onto their resume are usually unconfident new hires, people who haven't really worked in the industry much, or they've done a little bit, but they're really worried about looking and appearing professional. And the thing is, you have to consider the other side of that coin. If I, the hiring manager, have to go through 1 to 200 resumes, the idea of reading a full 3-page resume and trying to distill all of that information down into the stuff that's actually relevant and cut out all the fluff that you included to make yourself look better is really exhausting and frustrating. And so the chances are that resume is going to be either read last, or it might even go straight in the trash without getting looked at all. And that's a shame, because you're probably pretty good. Actually, you know what? I lied. That wasn't the last thing. There's one more. Work descriptions. The way you set up your work description is super important. For example, I could describe my last job as a synthetic data lead in a few different ways. Number one, I could make this bulleted list work description where I say, I worked on making synthetic data with Blender. I used Python for data generation. I worked with other teams and did data generation with them. I validated the data. I kept the system up to date. But that's really, really vague and it doesn't sound great. Instead of that, I would write it like this. Bullet one, I led the development and execution of synthetic data strategies enhancing model accuracy and operational efficiency. Bullet two, I designed and implemented advanced data generation techniques using custom procedural 3D rendering pipelines. Bullet three, I collaborated with cross-functional teams to tailor our synthetic data solutions to specific project needs, improving data availability and privacy compliance. You get the picture. You can read the rest of this here in my example, but the idea is these two examples are essentially saying the same thing, but one of them is doing a way better job of it. It's often stated that you have to really inflate your achievements to write a good resume, and while that probably can help, in my opinion, doing this is more impactful. See, I'm not actually stating that I did anything more in my second example, but I am providing detail in places that it matters. As a hiring manager, I want to know more about how you did your last job. And I want to know not just that you worked with other teams, but why and how that work improved your project. The key to writing this type of job description is to add detail, but in places that matter. It's a balance of using enough industry lingo that the hiring manager looking at it knows that you know what you're doing, but not so much that it's unreadable to the recruiter who's definitely going to be the one looking at it first. So now that we've gone over all of that, let's take a look at a resume I would actually move to the interview pile. Here's one I've created as an example. The first thing that should stand out is just how simple and readable it is. There aren't any fancy graphs, and the resume is just simple, plain text, but it's elegant in that simplicity. The next thing you should notice is how carefully I've pared down the work experience to basically only the most relevant stuff for the field I'm applying in. The resume is well organized, with the work experience appearing in order, and short explanations for any date gaps. The work experience section is detailed and well written, but not overly verbose. Now, one other thing that you can do here if you're having trouble explaining a gap in your resume is to use the magic words of the industry, project under NDA.